Hi everyone, this is Lahiri from ABC's of Anesthesia, and right now I'm going to be demonstrating the front of neck access or surgical airways. Now, this is in the context of your difficult airway algorithm. So for example, whatever algorithm you're using, whether it's the difficult airway society or the vortex approach, you're going to be trying all the different methods of supraglottic airway access. For example, you might be trying to bag, mask and optimize that, use an LMA or intubate with laryngoscopy, and maybe even try a video laryngoscope. Now, if all of these things are failing, that's when you need to start preparing for a surgical airway. And so that's what we're going to go through. So let's get started. So once you realize that you need to prepare for the surgical airway, there's a really, really useful flowchart or algorithm that a lot of us follow in Australia, and that's Andrew Heard's algorithm. His algorithm, the suggested first technique is a needle cricothyroidotomy. Now, they've suggested the needle because this was the most familiar technique for most anaesthetists. Anaesthetists are really used to putting needles in, probably less familiar at doing incisions with a scalpel. The equipment I need is some saline, the 14-gauge insight cannula, and a 5mm syringe. And then I've got to make sure I've got some kind of rapid oxygen or jet ventilation oxygen device. And here we have the Leroy Rapid O2 device, and I've got some oxygen there as well. So first thing I do is I take a 5mm syringe and I put 2mm of saline. So I want 2mm of saline because you want to be able to aspirate air into the chamber to confirm you're in the right spot. If I filled it with 5mL, I wouldn't be able to aspirate that air. So 2mL of saline is probably the right amount. You want a 5mL syringe because it's probably the right size to hold. You know, what 2mL syringe is too small, 10mL syringe is probably a bit too bulky. Next thing I do is get my 14-gauge needle, take the top off. So you really need one of these cannulas where you can take the top off. And I load that syringe on there. The next thing I'm doing, I'm looking for that cricothyroid membrane. So here we have the thyroid prominence, and I've got the cricoid ring here, and in between is a cricothyroid membrane. Now I use about a 45 degree angle, and then now I've got this grip on my cannula. So as I'm inserting, I aspirate. Now as soon as I get positive aspiration of air, I stop, and I really stabilize my device, and I pass the cannula down. Now notice I'm not moving the needle at all. So I've passed the cannula. Now, at this point, I never let go of that cannula. I then take the needle off and put that in the sharp spoon, and then I, using one hand, get rid of that air. This next step is absolutely critical. I want to confirm that I'm in the right spot. So the way I do that, I want to reattach my syringe, and then I want to confirm aspiration of air. Now, what you notice is that the plunger doesn't recoil. If this was in the wrong position or up against an obstruction, you'd get recoil of that plunger. Now I'll demonstrate what that looks like. So if I was in the wrong position, such as a blockage or the wrong site, I'd aspirate, and you could see that there is air in the chamber, but if I let go, you see the plunger recoils. You know that that's in the wrong position because there's no free aspiration of air. So now once you've confirmed in the correct position, I need to jet ventilate. Never letting go of the cannula or getting someone else to hand you this equipment, I get someone to connect my rapid oxygen device to the oxygen cylinder and turn the oxygen on. And you can turn it on to 15 liters, absolutely fine. I then connect this, it's a Luer-Lock connector, and I insufflate for 4 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then I let go. Now, 4 seconds at 15 liters per minute with this device is probably about a liter of oxygen, and that's probably all you need to make sure that you get a rise in the saturations and oxygenation to keep your patients safe. Now, a little bit about jet ventilation. So jet ventilation is a really effective way of getting oxygen rapidly into the lungs, but it also has a lot of dangers. If you're in the wrong site, it can cause subcutaneous emphysema. And even if you're in the right site, say you're in the trachea, too much airflow into the lungs and the trachea can cause barotrauma. So just imagine that you've got an obstructed airway. So at the top, there's complete obstruction and the only aperture is an in aperture there through this needle. Rapidly insufflating that much, you know, that many liters of oxygen can cause barotrauma pretty easily. So what they say is insufflate for 4 seconds, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now that's about a liter of oxygen. I wait for over 20 seconds because that's what it takes for the sats to rise. And then I let it fall. And what they say is 5% of the maximum achieved. Then I can give another 2 seconds, 1, 2. Now, what this does is it makes sure that I am giving oxygen, but I'm not overventilating and giving the patient the risk of barotrauma, which is a real risk. Now, this device is actually a particularly good device because it's got quite a large orifice here. Now, this is important because you get a lot of tactile feel. If I'm just insufflating, I'll feel not much back pressure, but as soon as there's an obstruction, You can hear that difference. That's unblocked and that's blocked. And you'll feel an incredible amount of back pressure there. So you'll get a lot of tactile feel from this device simply because the tubing is quite large and this thumb position here is also quite large. So once I've got the patient to a level of safe oxygenation, I can then convert this to a Melker kit. So I remove the rapid oxygen device. So the Melker kit is essentially a wire, a dilator, and the tracheostomy device here as well. So that's what it looks like together, and this allows you to pass this over the wire and then, you know, railroad it across with a Selzinger technique into the trachea. It also comes with a scalpel. Now the way I convert this, again, I've never let go of this cannula. I pass it through. Once, you know, it doesn't take too many centimeters to be in the trachea, so even 4 centimeters in is absolutely fine. At which point I then very carefully take the 14 gauge cannula off. At this point, I need to widen the incision. So I have the scalpel alongside my wire, pointing the blade down. I just make an incision, and you need to make this big enough to fit this. So, you know, you're 5 millimeters, 1 centimeter. At this point, you really just need to be able to get this kit slowly in. I then hold my fingers right to the tip so it's really close, and that way I can really easily fit it on without the tip wobbling. Now imagine you're trying to do this like this, you might have a bit of a tremor and it's a lot harder to get through, whereas this makes it a lot easier. So pass the wire, you always want to see the wire before you start your motion. Now there's a number of different grips you can use, but the most important thing is all of these three devices are held together. So the grip I use is one that holds the wire without bending it too much, because you don't really want to, you know, cause too much resistance there. And I also hold this dilator to the Melker kit and make sure that it's flush there. I then, using a rotating kind of motion, pass it through and make sure it's inserted into the trachea. I then take the wire and the dilator en masse out. And once that's in, I take my Liddell bag and I start test ventilating. So there we have it. That was the needle crack technique converted to a Melker tracheostomy set. So thanks so much for watching this series of videos. I hope they were really useful to you. Please share with anyone who might be interested, and we'll see you next time for the next video.